Blackstone Audio presents Birthright, The Book of Man, by Mike Resnick. This book is read by Tom Weiner. To Carol, as always, and to my parents, William and Gertrude Resnick. Prologue. The Beginning. Eons passed, and man slithered out of the slime, sprouted limbs, developed thumbs. He stood erect, saw the stars for the first time, and knew that they must someday be his. Still more eons. Man grew taller, stronger, broader. He strode the face of his world, taking what he needed, spreading his seed across the length and breadth of it. He became clever, if not wise, strong, if not indomitable. Earth was his, remade in his own image, yet man was not satisfied. He reached the moon, and in short order had erected settlements on Mars and the inner planets. The asteroid belt came next, and by the dawn of the 25th century, his ingenuity had allowed him to place metropolis after metropolis on the moons of the outer planets. And there he came to a halt. A trip to the moon took a mere 10 hours. Even a journey to Pluto, while it required 4 years, was conceivable. Conceivable and possible, as three growing cities gave testimony. But the stars were another problem altogether. The nearest was almost 5 light-years from Earth, an inconceivable distance, even for this technically oriented century. Not only would the trip require 6 long-lived generations, but the ship would need an enormous amount of room for oxygen-giving plants, making the venture both financially and physically unfeasible. So man looked elsewhere for a solution. The concept of hyperspace was tackled by every scientific mind in the solar system for more than a century. The sole conclusion, reached countless times in countless experiments, was that hyperspace was a myth. And then, in the early years of the 27th century, a young Tritonian scientist devised a theory for an engine that would propel a ship at a faster-than-light speed. The scientific community scoffed at him, citing the long-standing theories that made a tachyon drive impossible. But the solar government, in overpopulated desperation, funded his project. Within 2 years, the ship was complete. It was taken out into space some 75 million miles beyond Pluto and set into motion. It disappeared immediately, and neither ship nor pilot were ever seen again. However, the total transmutation of mass into energy and subsequent explosion predicted by the men of science was also undetected, and more ships were built around the faster-than-light principle. As Aristotle's earth, air, fire, and water had kept man from discovering the true nature of atoms and molecules for an extra 1,000 years, so had Einstein kept him from the stars for 500 millennia. But no longer. There were immense problems at first. 43 ships disappeared from the sight and knowledge of man forever, before one returned, and the one that did come back plunged into the sun and continued right on through it. It was another 1.5 centuries before an acceptable braking system was developed, and 60 additional years before the ships could maneuver and change directions in terms of mileage rather than light years. But by the advent of the 30th century, man was ready for his rendezvous with the stars. Proxima Centauri was the first star he visited. It turned out to have no planets. Neither did Alpha Centauri, Polaris, or Arcturus. Man discovered planetary bodies in the Barnard and Capella systems, but they were huge, cold, ancient worlds, totally devoid of life. He made his first alien contact on the 5th planet of the Sirius system. The inhabitants were small, fuzzy little fluffballs with no sensory organs whatsoever. Since the Sirians had neither eyes nor ears, nor apparently brains, man couldn't ask them for living space on the planet, so he simply took it. It was only after a small atomic war between 2 human cities 1 century later, which totally obliterated the Sirian population, that man discovered the little creatures were empaths, who had been killed by involuntarily sharing the agony of the war's victims. By that time, it didn't matter, though. Man was the dominant life form on Sirius V, just as he was on 100 other planets sprinkled across the galaxy. He trod with a cautious foot when necessary, a diplomatic foot when expedient, and an iron foot when possible. After 7 more centuries of exploration, colonization, and selective imperialism, man had built himself an empire of truly galactic scope. He lived on only 1,400 planets, while 2 million worlds were inhabited by other life forms, but there was no doubt as to who was the master of the galaxy. It was man the industrialist, man the activist.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.